going to compare gene expression in prokaryotes and eukaryotes by way of review. So let's start out with prokaryotic gene expression, up until the details of translation anyway. So here we have a stretch of prokaryotic DNA that we will define as an operon. And an operon in prokaryotes is a cluster of genes, say gene 1 here, gene 2, and gene 3, that are coordinately transcribed. That is, there's a transcription unit which transcribes all three of these genes at once into one messenger RNA. And that messenger RNA is polycistronic, meaning that the same messenger RNA is decoded into three different proteins. That is, there are three different genes that are transcribed into one mRNA. And transcription starts at the plus one site of the gene. We call that the plus one is the start of transcription. And you'll notice that there is a start of translation for gene one and a stop of translation of gene one. So we'll say that the stops are in red here. And there is a start of translation for gene 2 and a stop of translation for gene 2. And there is a start of translation for gene 3 and a stop of translation for gene 3. So that in the messenger RNA that is transcribed from an operon, there are coding sequences for three different proteins. So we can highlight those as follows. There's one, there's two, and here is three. So we have three different protein coding regions in the same messenger RNA. And at each, for each one, we have a start. We'll say start. And we have a stop. And that is true for each of these, such that translation will begin at the start, at the starts, and translation will stop at the stop signals, when codons for the stop of translation are encountered. Now, upstream of the plus one transcription start site, there is a sequence of DNA, which is the promoter, and it is to the promoter that RNA polymerase binds through mechanisms that we've already discussed. The sigma subunit of the RNA polymerase binds to the promoter, loads the polymerase here, and as transcription begins, the sigma subunit is released and elongation of the mRNA occurs. Now, upstream of the first translation start site in the messenger RNA is a 5' untranslated region, which contains a sequence, I'll highlight it thusly, contains a sequence in the 5' untranslated region called the ribosome binding site. So in the gene that from which the messenger RNA is transcribed, there is information, a sequence of nucleotides that encodes the ribosome binding site found in the RNA, because the RNA is transcribed from the gene. And the ribosome binding site of prokaryotic messenger RNAs is then a sequence of nucleotides. It's called the Shine-Dalgarno sequence. Shine-Dalgarno. You'll often hear it referred to as that, which is the point at which the ribosome will bind and begin translation at the first start site. So that when translation begins and stops, each in this three gene operon that I've indicated here, each coding region encodes a different protein, protein 1, protein 2, and protein 3. Now, what is the advantage of prokaryotes clustering their genes in what we would call an operon? And we could say that an operon is then a cluster of genes which encode proteins. And these proteins are often involved in running the same biochemical pathway. So if we have a biochemical pathway here where we're converting, let's say, compound A to compound B to compound C to a product of the pathway, let's say that this is an anabolic pathway. Each of these steps is catalyzed by a particular enzyme, enzyme 1, enzyme 2, and enzyme 3. You can imagine then that the three proteins encoded by this hypothetical operon are in fact enzyme 1, enzyme 2, and enzyme 3. So the advantage of coordinately transcribing a single polycystronic mRNA, which coordinately transcribes three genes at once, is that when this biochemical pathway needs to run in the cell, we need enzyme 1, enzyme 2, and enzyme 3 to run this biochemical pathway. A common messenger RNA will allow for the coordinate expression of these three proteins, enzyme 1, enzyme 2, and enzyme 3, so that the biochemical pathway will run. Likewise, if transcription is shut off for the operon, we don't need product anymore. Let's say there's plenty of product around. Transcription of the operon will cease, and we shut off the production of the proteins required to run the biochemical pathway. So coordinate regulation by the production of polycystronic mRNAs is a very efficient way to coordinately regulate gene products which are involved in a common goal, a common biochemical pathway. Now, in prokaryotes, there is a single RNA polymerase, which, as we've mentioned, consists of the core enzyme and an associated sigma subunit. And the sigma subunit dissociates once transcription begins and elongation of the RNA proceeds. Well, let's compare that. One other feature is that in prokaryotes, we have coupled transcription and translation. That is, because there is no nucleus separating ribosomes from the DNA which is being transcribed, ribosomes can begin associating with the messenger RNA even prior to the finishing of transcription, as we've already mentioned. So that does not occur in eukaryotes. We do not have coupled transcription translation. So let's move over here to look at eukaryotic gene expression, and as far as we've covered it so far. So here we have DNA, and that DNA is transcribed from a plus one transcription start site, and we have a messenger RNA produced. Unlike prokaryotes, though, these messenger RNAs are monocystronic. That is, each gene has its own transcription unit. There is only, in other words, one RNA for one protein, or possibly more if there's alternative splicing, but there are not multiple genes clustered together. And upstream of the plus one site, as in prokaryotes, there is also a promoter to which, as we've seen, basal transcription factors bind. Basal TFs, which stand for basal transcription factors bind, which recruit RNA polymerase to the promoter. And there are three different RNA polymerases in eukaryotes, 1, 2, and 3, each one responsible for transcribing different classes of genes, as we've talked about. So if we're looking at Pol II transcription, RNA polymerase 2 transcription, we are transcribing genes that will encode a protein product. Now, one thing I forgot to mention over here in prokaryotic gene expression is that in the DNA is a defined site, which is a sequence of bases, which signals the termination of transcription. So we have transcription termination site here, which at which point transcription of the messenger RNA ends through a formation of a hairpin loop in the messenger RNA, which is dictated, of course, by the sequence of nucleotides in the DNA. In eukaryotes, there is no well-defined termination site. The polymerase transcribes and eventually will fall off the template DNA, releasing the messenger RNA. Now, for eukaryotic genes, there's also a translation start site and a translation stop site. But eukaryotic genes are broken up into exons. Say here's an exon, and here's an intron, and then here's another exon, and let's say here's another intron, and then here's the final exon. So that the RNA in eukaryotes will be processed by adding a 5' cap, and the 5' cap serves as the ribosome binding site, unlike the sequence of nucleotides that defines the ribosome binding site in the Shine-Dalgarno case, where the ribosome binds to a defined sequence of nucleotides in the mRNA of prokaryotes. Here, the 5' cap serves as the ribosome binding site, and the 5' cap is added post-transcriptionally. It's a post-transcriptional modification, whereas the ribosome binding site in prokaryotes is part of the messenger nucleotide sequence as dictated by the sequence of nucleotides in the DNA. We polyadenylate, poly-A tails are added to the 3' end of a eukaryotic messenger RNA. So we add poly-A tails. And we add a 5' cap to the end of the 5' end of the messenger RNA. And then, of course, in addition to these two post-transcriptional modifications, we also have splicing, so that the exons present in the messenger RNA, say exon 3 is here, are brought together by splicing out of the introns. The introns are spliced out. And with these three modifications, then, we end up with a messenger RNA, has a poly-A tail, has a 5' cap, and has the exons of the gene joined together. Exon 1, say, exon 2, and exon 3. Now, as in prokaryotic messenger RNAs, there's also a 5' untranslated region of eukaryotic mRNAs, because the start of translation will be downstream of the start of transcription. So the start of translation occurs usually in the first exon of the gene of the mRNA. And there's also a 3' untranslated region that occurs after the stop of the stop site of translation. So we've gotten essentially a nice comparison of eukaryotic and prokaryotic transcription and of gene expression up until the point of translation. And unlike prokaryotic gene expression, we do not have coupled transcription and translation in this case. Here in eukaryotes, we must take the mature mRNA that is produced by these post-transcriptional modifications, and we must have mRNA export. So all these steps leading up to translation are points at which, in both in prokaryotes and eukaryotes, are potential points of regulation of gene expression that we will be considering shortly. And so now it's time to move on to translation, and that is where we'll be going. We'll be looking at both prokaryotic and eukaryotic translation, and come to understand how it is that amino acids are specified in a polypeptide chain based on the nucleotide sequences that are present in the codons of mRNAs in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So we will pick up with translation in the next part of this lecture.